coming up on This Week in Radio Tech. Look out, because Radio Systems has stopped making these. But never fear. Mike Dosch is our guest. He'll explain where you'll get your next ones of these adapters, coming up next on TWiRT. This Week in Radio Tech is brought to you by Broadcasters General Store, with outstanding service, savings, and support, online at bgs.cc. By the Ruby console from Lavo, see Lavo in your future at lavo.com/twirt. By Angry Audio, audio problems disappear when you get angry at angryaudio.com. And by the Calrec Type R console system. Type R is a brand new, modular, expandable IP-based radio system from Calrec Audio. Hey, welcome into This Week in Radio Tech, episode 451. This is the show where we talk about everything from the microphone to the light bulb at the top of the tower. And this week, quite a bit more we'll be talking about. I'm Kirk Harnack, your host, and I'm here live in the Telos Alliance studio in Nashville, Tennessee. And very appreciative to the folks at Telos for providing me this time and some of the gear here in the studio to do the show. Thanks a lot, Telos Alliance. Really do appreciate you. And I work at the Telos Alliance. So if we happen to mention some of their stuff, I kind of know about that. I'm also a part owner of 14 radio stations. As I affectionately say, I own the part that doesn't make any money. And that's why I work full time at Telos. And we do this podcast. So we're delighted to have you along with us for it. We've got a great show today because it's very timely. We do call it This Week in Radio Tech, and this news and the topic that we're going to be talking about is pretty fresh, and I think there's some good news here, although there was some drama earlier, so we'll get into that in just a minute. Joining me from, I don't know where he is, it's Chris Tobin, somewhere in the New York City area. Chris, hey, welcome into This Week in Radio Tech.
Hello, Kirk. Yes, I am in New York City, and it's I'm local. I'm not in a booth, a voice booth or a studio hidden somewhere elsewhere, so no, this is good. Just having a good time, relaxing, enjoying a Thursday. It's nice.
You know, for years, I've had, and if you do a wide shot on me, I've had these Duro loudness meters right here, but I've never had them hooked up to the microphone. And after having them here for literally years, I finally split the mic feed and went through some Telos live wire gear here. I can put different things on the meters, but one of the things I can put on the meters is my microphone. So how about that? For almost a decade, the mic has pretty much directly fed into the computer, and it goes to the GFQ network for switching. But I finally got around to getting a Y cable and splitting it and going into the live wire, the Axial live wire network here, where I can punch it up and put it on the meters. So there you go. Now we won't have random audio on the meters. It's actually my voice. Now I got to work on getting the entire program feed. So when Chris talks, you know, it's on there too. Or when our guest talks, it's on there too. Yeah, don't push it too hard.
You have live wire. It should just be plug and play. I don't understand.
Yeah, I know.
It's you can just call that company. They have tech support that's really good. I heard.
They do.
Give a call. They're more than happy to work with you as long as you have the right products. And they will ask you if you turned it on first.
There's another new addition here in the Telos Alliance studio, and it is these panels right here. This is the Telos Infinity intercom system. It is an IP-based intercom, although that's not the big story. The big story is there's no central matrix. And in some future show, we'll talk about this, but this is so cool. We hooked it up yesterday. I was talking with Brian Jones in Telos support. He's in Vancouver, Washington State. And this has the availability of Opus codecs between them in the link option. And we were just, intercomming between, here and there. And it's just as cool as it could be. And then you can also listen to other stuff like, there's a stream receiver that I have going on here. And here's an FM radio. Not because I can't talk to that radio station, but I can sure talk to Brian Jones. So anyway, we'll study that on a future episode. It's pretty cool. It's all IP connected and no big honking central matrix. So that's all cool. But hey, we're not here to talk about intercoms or Duro meters. We're here to talk about, we'll just get into it. How about that? So I don't know what to say. Let's bring in our guest. It's my friend and former boss, Mike Dosch. Mike, welcome into This Week in Radio Tech.
Hi, Kirk. Hi, Chris. How are you guys doing?
Doing well.
Good. Good to see you, man. Good to see you. So,
I'm just on the street from here, Kirk.
Yeah?
But I have to go on TWiRT to see you, even though you live up the road a couple miles here. So it's kind of weird.
You know, I had lunch today down in your town. I was at Puckett's in Franklin today. Yeah. You've been to Puckett's, right?
I've not, no.
What?
You recommend it?
Highly. Everybody recommends Puckett's. Okay. Yeah.
All right.
And they have live music on certain nights of the week. I'm not sure which ones. Not for lunchtime. Everybody seems to like the hot chicken sandwich.
Okay. I'll have to try that out.
Plenty of grease and carbs and hot and some chicken, too.
Okay. Sounds like Nashville.
It does. So, Mike, you've been on before telling us about happenings at Lavo, one of our sponsors here on the show, and some of the things that they've been doing. You've also been on the show to talk about Angry Audio, the really cool gizmos and gadgets that Angry Audio makes that you've designed to help make engineers' job easier. But this week, we're going to go to commercial here in just a second. But can you kind of give us a little teaser on what we're going to be talking about today?
Well, this was your idea, Kurt.
Yeah,
I think you reached out to me a couple of days and said you'd heard some news in the industry and you were wanting to explore it. And the news, look at that. He's got a prop. That's cool. The news is that that Radio Systems, the company behind StudioHub, has decided that they're not going to be manufacturing anymore. And so that's kind of some disappointing news for a lot of customers, because StudioHub has become a pretty significant way that broadcasters wire up their studios lately. And we can talk a little bit about that. But the answer is, the question is, how does this affect me, the broadcaster? And we have a pretty cool answer for that. And and we can also kind of give you some insights into what's going on with Radio Systems.
Good. Oh, okay. Good. All right. We had Radio Systems founder and owner Dan Braverman on our show years ago. He was on one of our first shows, like show number 5 or 6 or something like that. And I like Dan a lot. I've known him for a long time, and I kind of figured out why I've always liked Dan is because he was the first person who wasn't a radio station to ever offer me a job. And I was really happy with what I was doing at the time, so I did turn him down. But I was just delighted to have been offered a job by Dan. So anyway, Dan's good people, and we're going to talk about, as you said, what StudioHub is doing, but more importantly, what's coming after. But we got to take a quick break. We're going to get into all that. And there's one more topic we're going to talk about that Mike Dosch agreed to talk about, and that is this topic of de facto standards and how they affect us as engineers, how they affect an industry, maybe even, how de facto standards affect other industries as well. But I'm really interested in the topic of de facto standards. So we'll get into that in the second half of the show. This Week in Radio Tech is brought to you in part by our friends at Broadcasters General Store. Let's hear from Innovonics. We'll be right back.
The Aaron 655 is the latest addition to the Innovonics family of rebroadcast receivers, designed specifically for FM broadcast translators, also referred to as relay transmitters. The Aaron 655 is unique as an uncompromising DSP-based HD radio and FM receiver combined with a powerful 3-band audio processor and dynamic RDS encoder. IP connectivity adds streaming capabilities, and a web browser interface gives you total remote control of the unit from any PC or mobile device. The Aaron 655 gives you maximum flexibility for program sources. Select program audio from analog FM, digital channels HD 1 through 8, streaming sources, and analog or AES digital line inputs, all with assignable failover audio backup. The internal RDS encoder allows you to customize your RDS messaging. You can use incoming off-air RDS data, convert HD radio pad data to RDS, convert streamed metadata to RDS, or receive IP telnet data. Comprehensive audio processing includes gated and windowed AGC, a unique syllabic leveler, 3 bands of compression, and both wideband and independent HF limiting. Easy setup is achieved by using 10 factory presets and 10 customizable presets. The processor also supports dayparting, allowing automatic preset changes to follow different programming formats throughout your broadcast day. The front panel has an OLED display and jog wheel with intuitive menus for easy setup, advanced control, and editing for all operating parameters. The Aran 655 dynamic web interface gives you total remote control of the unit from any PC or mobile device. A comprehensive set of menus includes a quick overview of now playing info, input-output control, processor options, RDS encoder, alarms and notifications, SNMP settings, and much more. You can also listen to the live audio broadcast streamed through the web interface.
Thanks a lot for Inovonics and the Aran 655 for sponsoring This Week in Radio Tech, available from Broadcasters General Store. Oh man, you gotta love these people. I've been buying from Broadcaster General Store, since my days in engineering for Sam Phillips back in Memphis. Holy cow. He would say, "Kurt, get them pretty girls on the phone and order me a processor." So I'd dial up 352-622-7700 and talk to the pretty girls, actually anybody there at BGS, or you can go to the web, bgs.cc. Check them out. They are wonderful people and they will track your order and help you right out. Great prices too at Broadcaster General Store. All right. We're talking with Chris Tobin and Mike Dosch. Mike is known throughout the industry for a lot of things, even beginning way back in this PR&E days. But Mike, we're here to talk about these things. People call these dongles, but they're really, I believe, properly termed adapters. This one is a female, there we go, female RJ45 to XLR. And I like to recall the story that Dan Braverman told on this show, I believe, and he's told it many, many times to other folks, about what gave him the idea for using Cat 5 cable to carry audio. It really wasn't being done to any extent then. He was hired to wire up a radio station and several studios, and plus some IT guy was hired to come in and wire up a whole building worth of networking. And this IT guy, he turned him a kid, came in, and in a day and a half, was done. And Dan's still stripping cables and soldering XLR connectors, 5 days into this. And he said, there's got to be a better way. Is this a story you've heard as well, Mike?
I've heard this story, Kirk. It's a good one. And I think it was Sirius XM. I do actually believe that was his first big project with this concept where he implemented it the first time. And, so it's actually been 20 years and the products are still working. I have to tell you, kind of my side of this, it was Steve Church who said to me one day, he really loved this radio systems approach he just loved the mod jack. He just thought it was the coolest thing. And Dan's really got the right idea and we should implement this. And I said, "Oh, Steve, I don't really like it that much." "Oh, why not, Mike? This is really cool. This is really going to work." And I don't know. I just don't really like it. I'm kind of traditionalist. I want to use XLRs on our nodes. And I guess you remember who won that argument, by the way. The initial Axia nodes all had RJ45 connectors on them. So Steve won that argument.
Would you correct a memory? I have a memory, and I'm sure it was Steve who began this, but it seems as though a long time ago, you handed me a prototype Axia node, and for the audio connectors, I could have sworn that it had D-sub-15 connectors, just as the satellite receiver people were using and still do. And no,
we never did one.
No. Well, then I don't know what I'm smoking.
We did use D sub 15s on the logic boxes for GPIO.
Sure, sure. Yeah.
So
yeah.
That might be what you're conflating that with audio, but no, we all from day one, we had RJ45s on the original nodes.
Okay.
And then on the X nodes.
But I remember you talking to me about these RJ45s, and I do remember telling you, I love them. And you probably said, "Well, what do you love about them?" I said, "Well," and I just regurgitated what Dan always said. "Well, they're gold plated and they get better when you wiggle them. I mean, they're self cleaning, and they're cheap, and so, and they're good in so many ways." I'm sorry, I didn't interrupt you. Go ahead.
Well, no, it's everything you say is relevant to what we're talking about here. I mean, they have really taken off, and radio broadcasters in particular have really fallen in love with this. And, you know, for a lot of reasons, but not the least of which, and I have to speak as a product guy, I like the density. You know, because if you put XLRs in the back of a product, you can get, if you're really lucky, you can get 16 of them across, and chances are good you're not that lucky. You'll probably get 14 of them across. And so if you have an 8x8 stereo device, you're not going to do that with XLR connectors. And so we were able to get the density with the RJ45s. Later on with the X nodes, we put on D sub 25 connectors.
That's
and,
right.
Yeah. But we had both. We actually had the, and I think you still do. You still make the same product that I designed. It's RJ45s and DB25s both. And the reason for doing that is not because we didn't believe in the RJ45 anymore. We had a wonderful history with it. But we were getting requests from outside the radio industry. And this is kind of important because we'll touch on this a little bit later. Outside of radio, no one thought this was a good idea 20 years ago. So, you know, 15 years ago, we're trying to, you know, we're talking to the people at Skywalker, and we're showing them the back of our X nodes or our classic nodes rather, and saying, you know, they're looking at that saying, what's that? Well, you know, put audio on this. Oh no, we would never do that.
I was there. Yeah, I remember.
Yeah, their argument was, well, we need to have something that locks. Okay, so we went with the D subs because they have nice density and there's a lot of breakout options available. That's the AES-70. I get these all mixed up. I think it's the AES-59 format or 57 or something like that that defines the Tascam DB25 pinout. Okay, so, you know, that's what we ended up doing there. But as far as the radio guys were concerned, the RJ45s were just terrific. High density, easy to work with. You know, you just buy these cables off the shelf. And one more comment on this. It was Steve Lampin from Belden Wire. And you probably saw some articles that he wrote on this topic. He did a whole bunch of work to verify that this was a good idea, basically. And so Belden early on, I'm going to call this around 2000, had a cable that they called Media Twist.
Yes.
And so they were promoting this idea of using structured wiring with very consistent number of twists per inch as a great solution for sending analog and digital audio around. So there's actually quite a bit of science behind this. It's not just, you know, Dan had a good idea. It's actually Dan had a great idea. And then a bunch of people jumped on and said, yeah, you know what? This is actually pretty darn smart. And then kind of the last point on this is, I just told you 15 years ago, people outside of radio said, this is a horrible idea. You know what? The last couple of years, they're starting outside the industry, outside of radio, they're starting to say, you know what? This is actually a pretty cool idea. And so maybe later on, you can ask me about AES. And forgive me, because I always get these numbers mixed up, but I think it's 72. I think it's AES-72 that we can talk about. And that is that's a proposed standard for audio. See if this sounds familiar, audio wiring on RJ45 connectors.
Okay.
So even the AES is getting into this now.
We can, I'll look that up and I'll try to put the right standard number in the show notes. Okay. How about that? So people can look it up for themselves. But it becomes, I tell you, I always forget. Well, I don't always forget, but if I haven't used it for a while, I do forget. And it's really easy just to Google StudioHub pinout, and you'll get a bunch of images on how, if you're crimping your own connectors on, which I often do, if I don't have one of these available. I just built a studio in little old Indianola, Mississippi, a little black gospel radio station there. We put another console in there, and I didn't have quite enough of these with me. And so I ended up building a couple cables there as well. And I had to Google that to find out, okay, which one's the left and which one's the right. So I guess let's get right to the meat of the matter here about people have been told in the last week or so by broadcast equipment dealers, hey, I want to order this and this from Radio Systems, and they are told they're not shipping anything else. They're closing their doors. And if you go to the Radio Systems website, there's a message there that says we're not fulfilling any more orders. What can you tell us about that? And I guess as importantly, or more importantly, what have you been doing in parallel and have been gearing up to do?
Okay. I'll answer this a few ways, because there's actually three questions in here. You know, one is, so what happened to radio systems? And so I'll give you my view on that. The second one is, what does this have to do with angry audio? And I'll give you my answer to that. And then there's actually a third answer, which is, and does this have anything to do with LAVO, which is my day job? And the answer is yes to that, too. So let's start with radio systems. Dan Braverman, founder of Radio Systems and the guy behind StudioHub, has for various reasons decided that he's not going to manufacture products anymore. And you know, if you want the backstory on that and the dirty details, I would invite you to invite Dan to the show and talk to him about it, because I think that would actually be pretty interesting for your viewers. But I've seen a few Facebook group posts where people are wondering if, you know, if he's got a health problem or whatever, and I can assure you Dan is fine, and he's actually planning his next venture. But he has decided that he's not going to be manufacturing, StudioHub products any longer, radio systems products, I guess. And so what are they going to do next? Well, this actually, and I can't talk a lot about it, but I can give you a hint that it has something to do with my day job, which is LAVO. We are working towards some kind of collaboration between Dan Braverman Radio Systems and LAVO AG. So I can't really give you any more details on that, other than he's probably going to be ready to make an announcement here in a few months, and it's going to be pretty interesting. And that might be a good time for you to invite him on and talk about it.
Ah, okay.
Okay.
Okay, good.
And then the second answer, which I skipped over, is, so what does radio systems getting out of the business have to do with angry audio? And the answer is not a lot, other than we were already thinking about, and I've been thinking about this for about 6 months, getting into this area of the business, because studio hub type cables, you know, audio over RJ45, over Cat5, this is, you know, like you say, you call it the de facto standard in the radio industry. So, you know, the first thing I asked Dan 6 months ago was, if I make products for angry audio that ingest audio on the Studio Hub format, is there a license fee or anything like that? Oh, no, you just make your products and put them in the Studio Hub format, and that's great, which is also what I remember from Axia. You know, we just basically found the Pinout, used it, and everyone benefits. So I was thinking about this for the products, and then I started thinking, well, you know, it'd be kind of nice for some customers who aren't using Studio Hub to be able to buy adapters from us. And so as I started looking at the cost of building adapters, and I guess, you know, I don't want to go off on a tangent, but you remember that I lived in China for a year, mm-hmm. bringing Axia manufacturing online in China. And so I made a lot of friends, made a lot of contacts, you know, toured 100 factories. You know, this is, you know, building stuff overseas is just part of something that I do now. And so as I started thinking about building, or as I started thinking about products that use this format, I started thinking, well, why don't I just make some cables too? I mean, maybe I could compete and offer some alternatives. And at least at the time, it started to make financial sense. It started to look like, you know, commercially, there is room for a competitor. There is room for someone to go down a little different path and maybe offer some other alternatives or maybe some different price points. And so I started working on that. And then about 2 weeks ago, when this announcement came out, I started working on that really fast. So
okay.
kind of the answer is we're not directly related with what Studio Hub was doing, other than we were already in process of making our own products that do, I mean, not replacing 100% of what Studio Hub was offering, but addressing many of the most popular items that they offer. We already had this in process. And so, you know, as of a couple of weeks ago, we said to our supplier, okay, now we need to move very fast. And so that's what's changed. in terms of what we were planning on doing, kind of anyways. Coincident timing, we'll just call it that. We were already doing this, and now we're doing this very fast because a lot of customers have already told us, or they've told their dealers, this is gonna put them out. You know, what do we do? Where do we get this stuff? We've got projects. I need, you know, 30 of these things right now. And so we've been scrambling to basically pick up. I think there's going to be about a 1 month gap between them saying they're not going to do this anymore and us shipping. So we're probably about, I'm going to say we can start shipping some of these items right now today. And within the next 2 weeks, we should be able to ship all of them. And so I'm just hoping that we can keep the interruption to an absolute minimum. We don't want to disrupt anybody's business. So we'd like to you know, fulfill anybody's orders, you know, that would have otherwise gone to our competitor, which is no longer a competitor, but now the former company that did this, and now I guess we're going to be the company that does this, you know, competitors notwithstanding.
Now, I've got a key question for you, but I'm going to hold off for just a minute in asking you. It's a philosophical question about the couple different kinds of these cables that are built, but that's coming up. I wanted to ask if broadcast engineers today contact a dealer and want some StudioHub gear, are dealers knowing about your line of products and availability?
Yes, sir. We've let all the dealers know. Okay. We've published a price list. We've got all the cables up on our website already. We've been moving pretty fast since this announcement got made. Again, I want this to be as painless and automatic as possible. You know, we've even told the dealers, if you want to place your orders with the old part numbers that you used for StudioHub, we'll untangle that. You know, we'll figure out what our equivalents are and update your paperwork and ship you the right product. So we want to make it as smooth as possible for people. I guess that answers your question, right?
I just a little inside baseball here, and for Chris to know too, because Chrissy often doesn't know who my guest is until day of. And I wanted to point out that I know sometimes it seems like, hey, Kirk, sometimes your show This Week at Radio Tech, you're just being a shill for somebody. And you know, Mike and I have been friends for years and years. But as important as that is, these adapters are really important to broadcast engineers and their, I wouldn't say their livelihood, but their efficiency. I mean, if you're planning a studio project and all of a sudden you plan on ordering 50 of these and now you can't. Well, that's what all the buzz on Facebook and other social media has been about. These are important, and if you can't get these, you got to back up and punt. So that's why I invited Mike Dosch to come on the show and explain what's going on and what's going to happen now. And hey, Chris, maybe you can chime in on this question too. But then we'll give Mike the final word. I was introduced to StudioHub adapters in this format. So you've got a female RJ connector here. And by the way, you know, the early versions of this were kind of clunky. It was just, it was a boxy female connector here. And the other end is whatever connector you're buying. In this case, I've got a couple of male XLRs. You get female XLRs like that. You could get, you know, a quarter inch, eighth inch. You could get bare wires. You could get all kinds of different stuff there. But this was the format. And then you would plug this into the back of, you know, your equipment that didn't have an RJ45 audio connector on it, you know, a StudioHub type connector. And then you'd use whatever length of Cat5 patch cord you needed to get over to the device you're plugging into, which would typically have been, well, could have been a radio systems console. In my case, it would always have been an Axia node or X node. And of course, you plug these together and you got to pick the length that you need and off you go. And that's so this, to me, this is the toilet paper running over the front of the roll. That's how you do it. That's what I think. But then they started coming out with rolling the toilet paper over the back side of the roll. if you want to go with that standard, where you've got your connectors here, but this connector would just plug into the back of your device, your radio systems console, or your node, your X node, wherever it was going into. But you had to buy this in the right length. So I've got this little shorty here, but then I've also got this one Okay, so and I don't know how long this is. It goes and 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 it goes. And finally at the other end, oh, I've got a tangle there. Finally at the other end, I guess this is probably a 6 footer. You've got these connectors. So you can do it this way where you don't have, you don't want to provide your own patch cable, because then you just have to put, you know, a splice here or a dual female thing. So anyway, Chris, which is the right way? The toilet paper over the front or the toilet paper over the back of the roll? Which is the right way?
Both. It's all about the application. it's about the application and how you're going to put it to use. Because when I first was introduced to StudioHub back at the CBS Broadcast Center, we did it there. We came up with some interesting machinations of cables to adapt to our equipment. And because of the convenience of the RJ45, it was actually pretty cool. Yes, there was a lot of resistance and pushback from the techies. And they were like, no, you can't be doing it that way. There's no way it's going to work. And I said, well, let me point you to a person who works for a company that's doing it scientifically, if you will, and he's really good about talking the talking points. And that was Steve Lampin. And I said, if he can prove it, and he shows a network analyzer and a spectrum analyzer, he did it all on a lab bench, and I watched him do it, I'm going that route. So unless you can come up with a way to counter that, and we'll do a bake-off in a lab, we're going with this approach. Years later, we did Axie install, and we used the StudioHub format. And it was convenient because we had also our intercom system at the time was a Trilogy broadcast, and their entire system was based on RJ45 IOs. It was ideal. I was able to come up with all these special jumper cables that made it on the back, split it out to StudioHub, have my IO for my four wires, everything worked like a champ. We need to move something, just unplug it, move it, plug it back in.
Did that Trilogy intercom have the same wiring pinout, or was it a different wiring pinout?
Oh, no, it's a different wiring pinout, but I modified, I made a cable that would go from Trilogy to StudioHub, so I could literally move intercom heads around my plant and just plug them into the StudioHub horizontal wiring, if you will, and at the other end, just move it over to where I had to go.
And that difference is what?
How is that possible? It's really easy, actually.
Those different standards are one thing we're going to talk to Mike Dosch about. So, Mike, does the toilet paper go over in the front, or does it come out in the back?
I hate your analogy, but it definitely goes over the
back. Pretty terrible, isn't it?
Yeah, I'll tell you where the idea came from. Dan really hated this originally, but I was the guy that said, I really hate these little female adapter things because I always end up with patch cables. And this was primarily because I had a lab full of Axia gear and all these RJ45s out the back, and I'd have to use a patch cable and then a dongle to hook it up to my speakers and my other audio equipment. I didn't really like that very much. So I said, why can't you have males? And he made a pretty good case why that didn't make any sense. Same case that you made. And eventually he came around and started making, I'm sorry about the cat. It's just the way it is. So this is the problem of working at home.
They don't let you bring the cat to work?
I'd FedEx him to work if I could get rid of him that way. the male cables, and I know something about how, I'd say most people buy the female dongles that you like, that you prefer. So if it's democratic, then your way wins because more people like it that way. Mm-hmm. But if you're talking about the right way, it's definitely using a male cable to plug into the back of the Axion node so you don't have multiple connectors in there.
Yeah, well, I would agree with that. It's fewer connectors, but you've got to do something that Kirk doesn't do very well, and that's plan. You got to plan the lengths and order the right numbers and the right lengths. And frankly, it's this, no matter what length you buy, is cheaper than any length of this. And so true. I can use this with any length of Cat 5 jumper that I want to, and the Cat 5 jumpers are El Cheapo. And this is beautiful. It's elegant. But I have to plan.
In the Angry Audio product line, you may hang the paper in either direction. So we support both both approaches. So everyone's going to be happy.
So we're gonna break for commercial here in just a sec. But I got to tell you, the best use of this that I'm showing you right here. I pulled this off the back of a piece of equipment that I have here in my office. Here in the office, I have a Telos Zip 1 IP codec. And I need to be able to easily set it to whoever the caller is to play them audio from my office here, or to simply loop back what they're doing. So I was looking for, how am I going to make this loop back? And I don't want 2 6-foot XLR cables. I was going to loop the analog out back to the analog in and handle it that way. I thought, oh, that'd be easy. Well, you know what? I got these two males, two females, okay, for the output and for the input. And then I just took these right here and I put them together. And now it is totally looped. That is the easiest.
And you couldn't do that with just 2 little 3-foot XLR male to female cables.
Well, if I had 3 foot, I really need 1 foot, which now I have. I had to order some like for this NAB, but 7 years ago when I built this room, I didn't have that. So. All right. Hey, coming up in the next little bit, we're talking about, we'll finish up with this topic, and I'm so delighted that these are still available or are going to be off the shelf or within a couple of weeks or a month or so. But coming up, we're going to have a little bit more of a philosophical talk. Chris will be talking about this and Catfish, Mike Dosch, about de facto standards and what they mean for our industry. It seems like so many things that we've use in broadcast, we pulled from other industries, and some of them are not, you know, written down standards. They're de facto standards. We'll get into that. Our show, This Week in Radio Tech, it's Kirk Harnack, Chris Tobin, Mike Dosch is with us, and we're sponsored in part by the folks at CalRec. We'll be right back.
CalRec's Type R is a modular, expandable IP-based radio system featuring 3 slimline panels, a fader panel, a large soft panel, and a small soft panel easily configured to give the operator full control. Layouts are saved and recalled quickly between shows. A single 2RU core with integrated I/O gets customers up and running fast, and that single core can power up to 3 independent mixing environments with no sharing of DSP resources. Available in 4 DSP packs, and as your station grows, larger packs can be added, enabling it to grow with you. Power to the surface is supplied via standard PoE switches, keeping cabling to a minimum. Type R is fully AES-67 compatible, as defined by SMPTE 2110, which means that it is also compliant with NMOS discovery and connection management specs. All these features combined make Type R the most flexible radio console you can buy. Find out more at calrec.com/twirt.
Thanks a lot to CalRec and the Type R radio console for sponsoring This Week in Radio Tech. Hey, you know, studio guests, well, they're only human, like the 3 of us on the show. And humans cough and sniff and, well, they clear their throats even on the air. You can cure this with the Angry Audio Guest Gizmo. There it is. Press the cough button, mute the mic. Every guest needs one of these. You know what else guests need? It's headphones, which is why each guest gizmo also has a studio-quality headphone amp with individual volume control. Anything else? We've seen those mic arms with the built-in LED tallies. They look good, but how do you light them up? The Guest Gizmo does that too, illuminating the red light whenever the mic is hot. And installing the Guest Gizmo in your studio furniture couldn't be easier. All you need is a 2 3/4-inch hole saw, like that one, and a steady hand, no router required. Your studio gets a clean, custom appearance, and you get all the credit. Check out the Guest Gizmo and all the other cool gadgets at angryaudio.com. Angryaudio.com. Man, I wish I could use a 2 3/4-inch hole saw in my days of building studios. That would have been nice. Mike Dosch, you've got a whole story about that. This isn't the time to tell it, but that's an ingenious thing.
But your live read over the top of that was brilliant. So nicely done.
Oh, well, thanks. We need to change the ad sometime.
Okay.
Actually, we might change the ad to talk about these in the future. I could just go on and on, but let's not do that. Hey, if you just tuned in, it's This Week in Radio Tech, episode 451, with Kirk, me. Chris Tobin is in somewhere in the New York City area, and Mike Dosch is with us. Mike is a founder and head of angryaudio.com, and talking about, filling the void. Actually, he was going to fill it anyway, but this seems a bit like, Chris, you've been in this situation, surely. And Mike, maybe you have too, when you think, I've got 3 months to build these studios And then the general manager comes in and says, yeah, we've lost our lease and we need them on the air in 3 weeks. So, Mike, it sounds like you cranked up your game plan just a little bit to ship these.
Yes, we're moving very quickly. Not a lot of sleep the last week or two, but I think we're actually in pretty good shape. Like I said, we've got a bunch of them in stock right now. About half the ones we plan to build are already ready to go, and the other half should be here in the next week, 2 weeks at the latest. So anyone who needs these should be able to get them without too much interruption. That's the plan.
You know, one thing that people always talk about when, in the early days of Axia, and I'm sure I never built any studio hub per se studios myself until Axia came along, but I know plenty of engineers did. I've met a number of them on the East Coast, especially who built studios that were wired with studio hub wiring into, traditional digital and analog consoles before audio over IP came along. I just never had the opportunity to do that. But I looked at the pricing of, well, let's use this one, of what these things cost. And, you know, the list price nowadays of one of these is about $25. Now, I guess the street price might be a couple bucks less than that. And I know it went through my head, whoa, $25. Let's see, two XLR connectors and a female RJ and some wire. I think I can make that for a lot less until I started making a few and added up my time. I guess if you've got a factory making these, you know, it becomes worthwhile and you can make a business out of it. But if you're making these yourself, man, that's a lot of time, just a lot of time. Do you have some thoughts about the value of these pre-made versus the time value of making them?
I wouldn't want to make them. You wouldn't want anything that I made anyways. I'd try to burn the cable and burn my fingers it's not so easy to make them because the challenge is that you've really got audio cable there going from the endpoints back into the RJ45. So that's, you know, traditionally an RJ45 is going to have, Cat 5 type cable termination in there. So there is there's a little bit of extra work that has to happen there to get your, true shielded audio cable terminated the right way. And, there's a strain relief boot in there and everything else that, by the way, you misquoted the price a little bit. The adapters are they're $19.90. So,
okay. All right.
Yeah.
Sorry.
It's the cables, the ones you hate, the ones with the length of cable on them. Those are $24.90.
Oh, so that's about 25.
Another reason to go with the Kurt preferred method.
Chris Tobin, when I built this little studio in Indianola, Mississippi, I scrounged every last one of these I could find, and I was sure I was shy a couple, so I had to build up a couple of my own, and I used stranded Cat 5 cable, and luckily it crimped okay onto a RJ45 connector. I know that doesn't always work with stranded. There are ones supposedly that are made for stranded. And then at the other end, of course, I stripped it back, pulled the wires out, and soldered them onto some connectors. In this case, there was unbalanced stuff. It was some RCA connectors. And of course, you have to burn your fingers on an RCA connector. At least I do. Chris Tobin, what are your thoughts on making your own? And pay no attention. I mean, don't worry about offending Mike, but making your own or buying them?
Well, I prefer buying them only because if I'm working on a project, I want to make sure I have 100% reliability. I go in, get it done, and I'll get a call back. If I have to make it myself, it's a one-off. I mean, I've had to do it once or twice in a pinch, maybe working on something, realize, oh, we came up short. That's interesting. But no, I am not going to waste time doing that. I've done it. And to Mike's point, you need to be very careful. I've worked on many Cat 5 cable terminations where, oh, the crimp was great. And then you test it with the fluke test of it, and you find out that didn't pinch properly at all. After you do that two or three times, you realize just buy it. It's tested. It's ready to go. Done with it. How do you say it? Let's see. Let's work smartly, not hard. How's that?
There's a great deal of satisfaction. If you, I'm talking to you engineers, my friends, if you haven't wired a studio using these, so you've got, you know, one of the audio over IP systems that are out there on the market. Of course, I'm very familiar with the Axia stuff. And you're connecting it to traditional equipment, CD players or microphones or mic amps or headphone, whatever it may be. And you get to use these it's so satisfying to just click, 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 and it's hooked up.
It's all hooked up. But the reality is this: if you're building a project, you're building studios, you're whatever you want to call it, the time that it saves is time you put toward programming your audio over IP systems or video as well. That's where the savings, that's where the benefit comes from. So yeah, you want to build your own stuff because you're a tinkerer, that's fine. Build one or two just to be able to say you did it. After that, the other 50, you better buy. And that time you saved, you now sit at the computer and begin taking advantage of that audio over IP that you went to get anyway. See, that's how it works. If you want to do punch blocks, 66 blocks, or the ADC, what's the other ones? I forget the name now. Go ahead, knock yourself out. The time you spend mounting on the wall, time you spend punching it down, make sure you dress it nicely to make nice cable management, because if you don't, it looks like a mess. You've just wasted, because now you have to go back, sit down, start programming your nodes, your blades, or whatever you're working on, and it's 2 o'clock in the morning. Or you could start at 9 in the morning, get the wiring in place, the infrastructure's done, by noon, have lunch, come back and sit down and plan out your audio over IP distribution. Just saying.
Speaking of punch blocks and the time that it takes, let's see. I've often said that, you know, you can rip out all this wiring. You rip out literally hundreds or thousands of pounds of wiring. Not that we usually measure wire by the pound, but you can redo a whole studio facility and rip out literally hundreds or 1,000 pounds of wiring and replace it with some Cat 5 that works really well when you go to audio over IP. And a guy like our friend Robbie Green in Houston, he's posted pictures of the masses of wiring he's pulled out of an old facility. I guess I'm just... You know, I'm giddy over how much better wiring is. I've wired traditional ways. I've wired recording studios and broadcast facilities. But I'm so glad to pull wiring out and replace with just a few Cat 5s and carry lots of stuff over that. De facto standards. Mike, I'm excited about de facto standards that people really latch on to and work. And there's no royalty to pay for this. And everybody in broadcast uses this. That's not the same in every industry. What are your thoughts about de facto standards, and maybe as it applies first to StudioHub, what we call StudioHub, and maybe as to other ones as well?
Well, this is for Chris's benefit. I will tell the standards joke before Kirk does. We love standards. That's why there's so many of them. So, because, you know, that's... You're just going to say it. I know you are. So I mentioned to you earlier that outside of radio, you know, radio really has pioneered this idea of audio over Cat 5 with the StudioHub approach. And a couple of choices were made with StudioHub that were kind of interesting. One of the choices was made that it will be suitable for stereo connections, and it will also have power supply on it. So that idea is that you would be able to use an injector, like a mid-span injector that would inject plus or minus 15 and audio ground onto the cable itself, so that an endpoint, like a headphone amp or a mic preamp or something like that, would be powered up right over this cable. So your audio and your power would be on the same cabling system, which is a very clever idea. And that's unique to StudioHub. If you go outside of radio, though, you will now see, and it's just emerging. It's like, you know, I'm not going to say that this is really well established, but it's emerging now that other folks, live sound and recording studios, are getting this idea that the Cat 5 might not be such a bad idea for audio. And so you're going to hear of something called QTP, or quad twisted pair. And the idea is to basically use Cat 5 as a snake, because you can get, you know, four balanced audio signals or four symmetrical ASEVU signals on a single Cat 5. So a breakout end, you know, maybe four XLR males on one end and four XLR females on the other end and a Cat 5 in between. You got yourself a nice little snake, and that's pretty useful. And so this idea is getting some traction outside of radio. But what's interesting to me is that the AES is paying attention this time. And so there is this, and you know, I should have researched this before coming on the show. I think it's AES 72, but if I'm wrong, it's AES 73. And it's a proposed standard and it's very bizarre, actually. It's not really a standard. It's not like an AES 67 or an AES 59, where this is how we want the audio to be formatted on the cable. It's not like that. Instead, it's a labeling standard. So essentially, there's about 8 different recipes of how you might put audio on this, you know, on this quad twisted paired cable. Yeah, basically 8 different pinouts, essentially. Mm. And what the AES is proposing is that there's a standardized way of labeling these connectors, so that you, the poor audio guy, doesn't just, you know, jam a plug into a jack and say, well, it's RJ45 audio, so I can make an assumption here. Actually, if there's 8 different wiring, I'm not going to call them standards because they're not, but if there's 8 different wiring schemes, who knows what you're going to get. So the AES is proposing that there's a labeling standard, and it'll say this RJ45 is wired to a particular, you know, class, or, you know, whatever it is they call it, so that at least when you look at it, you'll know what to expect. You'll know what to do with that. And that's kind of interesting to me because, 20 years ago, no one from the AES was interested in this. So I think the idea is it's got legs and it's going to find its way into other industries.
AES 72-2019, because they could put the year on it now, is apparently the right standard. It's an application of RJ45 type connectors and quad twisted pair cable for audio interconnections.
There you go.
And turns out that Wardbeck Systems is offering for sale a number of these pre-made cables.
Yes, they have one of the 8 recipes, you know.
Okay.
Remember what I just said. You know, it's not an AES 72 standard. It's an AES 72 defines how you're supposed to label them so that the customer knows what he gets when, you know, but there's still going to be 8 different ways that people wire these things up, sadly.
Oh,
you know, maybe, and this kind of is to your point of the de facto standards, is that if the industry, if the customers in particular kind of push on this a bit, you know, maybe it'll get narrowed down. You know, if a customer says, like, for example, we did this at Axion, okay? We said, hey, if we're going to do this, we put audio on RJ45, let's use the StudioHub format. We made that decision, okay?
Yeah.
We could have made a different decision. We could have said, gee, we know better. Let's go wire it a different way. And some other manufacturers did go other ways. SAS has a different RJ45 wiring standard. Wheatstone at the time had a different audio wiring standard. So when we chose one, we said, let's do StudioHub because, you know, there's all these products out there that can support, you know, that particular format. We thought it was in our best interest to go that direction. And ultimately, this is kind of the value of a de facto standard. Ultimately, I think at some point Wheatstone changed their recipe. They said, it's probably better for us too to have StudioHub format instead of Wheatstone format, even though there's probably an engineer somewhere that could tell you why their format was better. Mm-hmm. You know, ultimately, you know, having devices that connect to other devices and actually work without translators and rewiring and everything else is a huge benefit to the customer, no matter how technically superior your particular recipe is. And I think that's kind of the benefit of de facto standards, but it's kind of also the drawback too. And that is, if there isn't a real standard that you can point to and say, yes, we're going to do it in this flavor because that's the way the AES has defined it, or that's the way the IEEE has defined it. The problem with de facto standards is you kind of give credibility to your competitors. And I know this one really well, and so do you, Kurt. Because when we launched LiveWire, I naively believed at the time that all of our competitors would gladly take this from us because we were going to give it to them all, no charge. Here you go. you know, every competitor had access to LiveWire in the early days. And we just said, you know, we'll help you implement it. We'll tell you what to do with it. And you go and make products and we'll compete on the merits of our products as opposed to my network's better than yours. And we both know what happened there. Yeah. Our competitors didn't like that idea very much because it gave credibility to Axia. They didn't want that. So they went and created their own standards, their own protocols. And to this day in radio, there's, I guess, about four different protocols that people use. And now you have to come along with something like AES 67 just to make a bridge so that you can use products with different protocols to talk to each other. And that's the downside of de facto protocols. You know, we could have said perhaps at one point LiveWire was kind of the de facto IP audio standard.
For a time,
Some competitors might not agree with that, but you know, for many customers, they would say, yeah, you know, we kind of, it would have been in our best interest if everyone had jumped on and done the same thing. And so that's kind of, I think, what you're talking about here when you talk about StudioHub. He was successful at this. And maybe precisely because he didn't require a license fee and he made it very open and, you know, just published it and encouraged manufacturers like Axia to, hey, use it, you know, put it in your product. And I think that might have been really what made it work, because if anyone had seen this as some kind of a threat, they would have tried to make their own version and made it a competitive issue instead.
And even though radio systems made their own distribution amps and headphone amps and a number of other electronic boxes, and a number of those had these StudioHub connectors on them, a lot of them didn't. But more importantly, nobody was really making structured wiring systems. I guess StudioHub was the first structured wiring system for broadcasters. Is that fair?
Yeah, well, maybe that's why it worked. You know, maybe that's why the de facto standard worked, is just because no one else tried it. Certainly people were putting RJ45s on their products, but they weren't all using the same pinout.
Yeah.
And so it was kind of the existence of all these StudioHub products, the cables, the adapters, the hubs, the power supplies, you know, the injectors, all of the accoutrement that made it all work, that I think forced the manufacturers in the industry to say, you know what, let's just use that. It's better. And we don't want to deal with that mess. Let's just use the same format.
Speaking of de facto standards, are we anywhere near done with the argument on XLR connectors if pin 2 is hot? Chris, are we in there?
I don't think that's going to ever end. I've worked at a place recently where pin 3 was hot, and I was like, wait a minute,
what?
It's been a while since I've had this happen. It's just, you know. So if you go by, what is it, the American wiring standard, black is hot, red is negative, or, you know, cold. And that's what people used to use. And that was the whole big thing.
Yeah. Yeah. Hey, we could have coffee over this all afternoon long, but we got to take one last break. We'll be back. And Chris knows this. Mike, if you can work up a tip of the week for us, keep our viewers and listeners through the next 2 minutes, then that would be just great. We'll promise them some words of wisdom from you and from Chris, and I might have something myself. So hang on. We'll be right back after this word from Lavo.
There has probably never been a better time in history to buy a new radio mixing console. Today's consoles are more sophisticated than ever, with more features and functions than you can shake a stick at. But have you noticed how complicated they are? There's a sea of knobs and switches and displays and buttons. Some of them look like you might need a pilot's license to do your show. Well, a board doesn't have to be complicated to be powerful. Just look at the new Ruby mixing surface from Lavo. The first thing you notice is how smooth and streamlined it is. Ruby has lots of cool tech, but what it doesn't have is that confusing ocean of buttons that clutter things up. Now, we all know that there are some console features the jock only uses once in a while. So why dedicate controls to them? Ruby fixes this problem by moving those once-in-a-blue-moon controls to a touch-sensitive, customizable GUI that happily shares screen space with your other studio software, helping you fight control room clutter. Thanks to this design innovation, talent that use Ruby produce smoother shows with less errors. Controls that are used the most fall naturally to hand, while functions that rarely need adjustment are easily controlled with just a couple of clicks in the context-sensitive GUI. And Ruby has cool features you won't find on other boards, like Auto Mix, an intelligent gain writing function that guarantees the perfect mix for multi-mic morning shows and call-in segments. Dual mode snapshots that instantly switch the motorized faders between on-air and production modes. And enough DSP and I/O options to make even your pro sound pals green with envy. And because quality is as important to Lavo as it is to you, every console is proudly built to fanatically precise standards at Lavo's own factory in Germany. If you're ready to declutter your control room, do yourself a favor. Check out the new Ruby and the other cool Lavo radio tech at www.lawo.com/twirt.
Thanks so much to Lavo for sponsoring This Week in Radio Tech. And if you use that URL, lavo.com/twirt, it'll take you right to the radio gear. And you'll bypass all the $500,000 audio consoles and get right to the radio stuff. And also know that we sent you. So thanks again to Lavo for sponsoring our show. It's This Week in Radio Tech. Kirk Harnack, Chris Tobin, Mike Dosch is our guest. And we're going to wrap things up with some tips. So who wants to go first with a tip of the week?
That's right. I go off. Okay, I'm sorry.
I usually don't have it, so I'm excited that I have something this week. Resplendence.com. There's a product there that's called Lakemon. And it's something that our support guys at Lavo have been helping customers with a while. It's a way to make sure that your PC is sort of configured and sourced and vision for audio.
Catfish, I'm sorry, but you're okay. I got it now. I didn't see it before. Of course, my picture. It's Resplendence. Okay, I got it. Resplendence.com. Thanks. I didn't hear it correctly the first time. So, I'm sorry. We had a little breakup. Can you Oh no, we're getting a lot. Chris, are you hearing Mike, or is it just me?
I'm hearing the same thing you're hearing. It's breaking up.
Gotcha. Okay.
His orbital path has shifted, and now we're losing. He's going out of range of the DSpace radio network.
Oh, no. All right. Well, we got the key thing. Oh, you're better now. Come on back in.
Am I better now? Okay. Yeah. I just wanted to say that as we get PCs to do more and more audio work, we have more and more problems with PCs not being suitable for audio work. So this is a free tool, and it allows people to see what kind of latency they have on their machines and whether or not they're suitable for doing audio work. And there you
That's
go.
That's cool. I see a lot of different tools here. Who crashed? Registry monitor. Why so slow? Latency mon. What do you recommend?
All of them.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, if you're going to use your PC to do critical audio, it'd be kind of nice to make sure your PC is capable of doing critical audio. So that's kind of the idea. Our support guys love this. They just send it out to, you know, they send it out to the customer and say, go ahead and run all of this stuff and then call us back. And usually the problem fixes itself at that point.
They have a program that is just for me. It's called Sanity Check. It's about halfway down the page. So, yeah. Okay, good. Well, we'll put this in the show notes along with the other things that you mentioned, Mike. So appreciate that. It is called Resplendence. Resplendence.com. We'll put that in the show notes. Chris Tobin, what you got for a tip of the week?
Well, I'll dovetail on Mike's suggestion with if you're going to be doing critical audio on PCs, let's think about how we're deploying those PCs. So get your thinking caps on, use that stuff between the ears if you can, and say, hey, if I'm going to use this computer for audio purposes, let me turn off all the features I don't need. Let me get rid of all the applications that are on this machine and strip it down to just doing one thing. Think of it like an ASIC chip, you know, application-specific integrated circuit. That's what I want this PC to be. Because I can tell you from working at one facility, a very large news operation, we were using audio over IP in software form for reporters in the field on Windows-based machines. And when the IT department gave us these great machines at the time, they were fast, they did all kinds of great stuff. Yeah, until that Windows update occurred, until that sudden sound, then be rebooted in the middle of a broadcast. Yeah, what was the other thing it did? A few things. So we quickly stripped them down. And after we did that, they ran just fine. Also, try and work with static IPs on these machines. Now, I'm not saying build a static IP list. Do a reservation on your DHCP server so the MAC address and IP stay the same. I can't tell you how many times I've worked with folks who want to do studio interviews with us at the radio station. And I tell them, look, I have the Comrex Opal, so all you have to do is I'll send you the link, you connect, and off to the races. We have a computer, we're working with Skype. It doesn't always work very well, and we're not sure if we're going to do that. And every time I hear it, I cringe. I just, like, lose. I'm about to do the Susquehanna Hat Company from Abbott and Costello. I'm like, are you kidding me? It's 2019, and you're having a problem with audio on a PC. I can't. Yeah. I said, tell you what, I have an ISDN. I'd be more than happy to let you dial into it. Great. And that's what they do. So for $5 a minute, they'll do the ISDN. Nobody has a problem.
Cool. Yeah. Figure.
So the tip is work with the equipment. Understand what you're trying to accomplish. Find out what the application needs for resources and make it available. And turn off all the automatic features on the PCs. Please do not think that's a savior. And talk to your IT department. If they give you a hard time, say, look, there's revenue attached to this machine. We got to work with this. You got to work with me. There's revenue attached. If you want to interfere with the revenue stream, contact the business manager and you guys have a discussion. Trust me, once you do that, you'll get what you need.
You know what? I think I like the ideas. And the phrase that you just said, there's revenue attached to this machine or this function.
Yes.
That is you've said that before. And man, that's a great argument.
It's business. It's not even an argument. It's like, it's basic business. Are you in the business of making money? Yes. Well, here you go. Here's a tool to do it. And guess what? You can look like a hero without even going out of your way.
And even though audio ought to be an easy thing these days with PCs, I'm telling you, updates still screw up the enumeration of audio devices in a PC. A good friend of mine, one of my best friends in the world, I built a studio for him, a VO studio. He called me up yesterday. Kirk, I got a terrible problem. I can't get audio out of Adobe Audition anymore. There's something wrong. And I said, "What were there any updates?" He said, "Yeah, Dell sent an update." I said, "Okay, that gives me a clue." And went inside, and sure enough, just in Adobe Audition, the device that it was thinking it was supposed to be using as its output device was totally the wrong device, and it changed on its own. I mean, my friend doesn't know enough to change it, so. It's and we've had that problem with lots of things where just devices get read.
That's
four little words for your friend.
Yeah. Yeah.
Windows. Actually, I guess it's five. Windows LTSC might not be a bad idea.
And long-term support something.
Yes, long-term support something. I don't know what it is. You asked me these questions, but it's at one point it was long-term support branch. And the idea was that this is the most stable Windows build, and it doesn't get all the updates, and it doesn't have all the consumer-oriented bits. So it's kind of built more for industrial customers. And we're getting more and more broadcast clients that are just insisting. They're just saying, this is, you know, it's ridiculous. We are not going to even consider Windows 10 anymore. We're only going to consider LTSC. In this case, so it's worth looking at.
Long-term servicing channel is what it's for.
That's it. There you go.
Good. Okay, that's a good tip too. We'll put that in the show notes. My quick little tip is, I've gotten a lot out of being a member of the SBE. I encourage you to join the SBE, but not only SBE. There's also IEEE, Broadcast Technology. But if wherever you are, if you've got a state broadcast association. You ought to be a member, maybe through one of your contract radio stations, maybe if you're a full-time employee at a radio station, be a member of that. Take advantage of what they have. Here in Tennessee, and I know in Kentucky and in Alabama and many other states, I'm going to Nebraska next month. They've got great engineering programs at the state level. But one of my favorite things is a state association known as the Tennessee Radio Hall of Fame. And these guys are amazing. Men and women. I'm not leaving women out. They really honor good people in the broadcast business who have devoted their lives and their talent to bringing great public information and entertainment to the masses. So I love being a member of the Tennessee Radio Hall of Fame, also the Tennessee Association of Broadcasters, and just to have a great time with us. So support your state broadcast association, even if it's something fun like the Hall of Fame. All right. All right. That's my tip. Mike Dosch, we got to go. Thank you so much for being a part of our show today. I really appreciate your time. And hey, thanks for bringing the sexy back. Oh, wait a minute.
Yeah, you're holding up the wrong one. Yeah, that's the Kurt the Kurt signature model adapter there.
Well, I appreciate it. Look forward to shipping those and keep in touch email or Facebook, and we'll look for those coming out the door.
Okay. Thank you.
All right. Thank you. Chris Tobin, thank you for being here. I appreciate it very much.
Oh, you're welcome. Thank you. And thanks to Catfish for the information and the fact that the product will continue on. It's even better. This is good.
Next week, our guest is Bill Sufa. So I hope I'm saying, is it Sufa or Sufa? Do you know, Chris?
I don't know. Anyway? I think I've heard Sufa. I think I have.
Yeah, Bill Sufa. I don't know what he's going to talk about. So we'll find out. But he's a pretty cool guy. All right, we got to go. Thanks so much to Chris and Mike. And thanks to Suncast, our producer, who keeps the show running on time. He's got to go. And also thanks to Andrew Zarian, the founder of the GFQ Network. We're going to go. See you next week on This Week in Radio Tech. Bye-bye.